But if you break the symbolism down, let's just start with the X. And if you cut it in half horizontally, this is basic symbolism. I'm sure most of you understand this. But you have the V symbol, which is the vessel, the chalice, the womb, the symbol for the female. When you flip it around, you have the sword, the phallic, the penis, the symbol for the male. But when you combine them to make an X, you have the allegorical union of male and female, heaven and earth, good and bad, all that stuff, I guess. And I got to this point with the Freemasons, and I looked at them and I said, okay, what's the hook? Help me. I need help. And there was about 150 of them there, and one guy raised his hand. And I said, yeah. And he said, a child? And I looked over at my wife and I went, duh. And she looked at me and she said, Sarah? And then, oh boy, did it get fun. But, you know, and everybody, of course, first thing we thought about was the Da Vinci Code, right? Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and their child. And you know what? That's probably right. In my mind, hey, men and women get together and have children. I don't care what time you're talking about. That's what I think, but that's me. But I think it's more than that. I think what it is it represents, that little hook represents the continuation, the perpetuation, a generation, if you will, of an ideology, this goddess ideology, and, I believe, a tangible bloodline. But that's me. And I'm sorry that Bill Mann isn't here, because I want to give him some, I want to thank him too, because I've had some conversations with him around this time, and I shared this with him, and he thought it was pretty good. And then he said something to me. He said, you know what, Scott? Don't forget about the Egyptians. And the second he said that, I'll never forget it. I was sitting at my office and I went, oh, something popped into my head. I hung up the phone with him. I said goodbye. I jumped in my car. I drove down to Midway Bookstore in St. Paul. I went to the Egyptian section, and in less than a minute, I found what I was looking for. It was a book on Tutankhamun. What do you see? The crossed crook and the flail, right? One represents the male god Osiris. The flail represents his wife Isis. And when they're crossed in this symbol, they represent kingship, royalty, and the crook carries the eggs, fertility. Is there a connection? Hell yes, come on. I think so. Are you kidding me? What's the goddess ideology? Well, I'm not 100% sure. I think I'm beginning to understand it. But I think that there is a connection, or as Alan Butler says, a golden thread that weaves through time. And this is an ancient religious belief system, and it goes way, way back to when humans first saw women give birth. They are the creators, right? Still are. At least that's what they thought. I use the, hey guys, try this one on your wife. Start calling her the goddess. Works pretty good, let me tell you. And it's true. And she pretends like she doesn't like it, but she does. But I think there is a golden thread, and it goes back before the Egyptians, and it weaves through the Egyptians, the Qumran Essene, and the Cistercians and the Templars. And this is some of the commonalities. They all wore white for purity. One of the things you'll see in the new book is I went back and I looked at these Egyptian kings. They all wear white, and they have red crosses. Check it out. Is there a connection? I think so. I don't have a picture. I should have thrown one in. They all practice ritual bathing. Remember those lavatoriums in the Cistercian abbeys? Very important to them. Same with the Qumran Essene and the Egyptians, the cult of Isis worshippers. They had elaborate initiation ceremonies. I know there's some people in the room that understand that. They also tended to large flocks of sheep. The sheep are one of the primary reasons the Cistercians became so wealthy, and certainly the Essene did, and you go back to the Egyptians, you see the same thing. They were associated with military orders. This is another commonality. And they closely tracked the movement of Venus. Now, there's some guy in the room, I think, that's going to talk about Venus later on in a different context. I can't wait. But I asked myself a question. Could there be a connection to Freemasonry? Between that would continue on after that Cistercian Templars? I think so. Let's talk about Venus for a second. The cycles of Venus. This planet has long been associated with love, sex, reproduction, and restored life. She was the manifestation in the heaven of the goddess. The planet Venus was very important, and the ancients tracked the movement of Venus along with the other heavenly bodies, as many of us know. And there's a very defined cycles that Venus has. One of them is the 8-year cycle. And what happens, and I want to give credit here to Ashley Cowie. He was the guy that said it must now be requestioned. And I had an opportunity to meet him when I went to see Niven and visit Roslyn earlier this year. And he talks about Venus, and I've looked into Venus, and this is his graphic. But basically, during its 8-year cycle, Venus spends 4 years of time as an evening star, rising in the western sky, getting to an altitude of about 22 degrees. Who was it that had an angle of 22.5 degrees? Somebody had that angle. I wanted to jump on that, but I wanted to wait until I got this. Something you might want to look into. And then it spends 4 years as a morning star in the east southeastern sky. And it rises, and when it sets every day, it makes a horn. And when it's a western star, an evening star, it makes a horn that's opposite. These are called the horns of Venus. And you see this symbol all over the place in ancient iconography. Here's Isis with the horns of Venus, and you have the sun disk, the male god, in the middle. Could this be the allegorical union of male and female going back to then? I think so. But if you think about the Venus, the other thing that it does during its 8-year cycle, if you track its actual movement relative to Earth, it makes a 5-pointed star. This is an ancient symbol that's been seen going back to standing stone sites thousands of years ago. And they're seen, as far as I understand, all over the world. So people were tracking Venus, no question about it. But in Christianity, we know that the pentagram, the 5-pointed star, represents what? The devil, right? Well, why would it be in a northern window here at Amiens Cathedral in France? Do you see that? If it's a symbol of the devil, why is it there? I don't know. But it's interesting that point, it's pointing down, right? What do you see in that little glowing window at the bottom? You see an equilateral triangle, which is the pubic triangle, the symbol of the goddess, where life comes from, right? Is there a connection? I don't know. Decide for yourself. And there's many other cycles, a 40-year cycle and other cycles. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but they use Venus as a calendar and a clock, and it's amazingly accurate. But there's another structure that I want to talk about. Remember, we went from Minnesota to Spirit Pond down to Narragansett Bay. And on the other side, the eastern side of the bay, there's this stone structure, 2-story round structure. I'm sure most people in this room know what it is. It's called the Newport Tower, the Mystery Tower. And nobody knows when it was built. Some people think it's a colonial window or a windmill. I don't. There are a lot of things you can talk about. And there's many people who have done some really good research on the tower with the architecture. Jim Whittall, I want to mention his name. He's done a lot of great work. Sue Carlson, many others. But the architecture is clearly Templar, no doubt about it. And this goes back to the two-story tower on top of the Christ's tomb in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, where the Templars were. When they came back, they started building round churches. I've seen them. Niven knows all about them. Many people do. But this is the architecture that is clearly Templar, and the Romanesque arches, the round tower, the octagonal footprint, the twin fireplace flues found in northern Scotland, castles. And there's also astronomical alignments. And the person who's really helped me understand these is Bill Penhallow in Rhode Island, retired professor of physics and astronomy. And he's documented many solar and lunar alignments. Oh, I'm getting there. But there's more. I asked myself, after going through all this research and trying to understand how these people's minds worked and if there was something to this, could there be Venus alignments? Well, I tell you what, if this is a Templar structure, there had better be Venus alignments. That's what I thought. And I'm not an astronomer, but I know a little bit about math. And there is some interesting things inside this tower. There are a couple of windows up at the top. You see that little window at the top in the southeast window? And there's one to the west. And in Bill Penhallow's work, he did not have an account for these windows. And inside the tower, there are niches. And he accounted for all the niches in the windows except for 2.